The war pigs. We're past all that in this day and age, right? We're not really interested in war anymore, are we? So I found this this interesting article I want to talk about. U.S. special ops around the country. Now, in the mainstream media and Trump himself have been saying that we're pulling the troops out of Syria, right? Well, are we really pulling the troops out of Syria? And what about we're pulling special ops out of Syria, right? We're a war nation, right? Aren't we? Is that what we are? We're war pigs, the American war pigs. So check this article out. Check this shit out. So from Tyler Durden at Zero Hedge reporting the expanding global footprint of U.S. special operations. Now, most people don't know about this, right? I'm finding it out for the first time, you know, like everybody else. The possibility of U.S. military withdrawal from Syria in the news on a daily basis. The mainstream media has been quick to parrot DOD's claim that Department of Defense's claim that 2,000 troops, mostly special operations, are to be withdrawn from the country, from Syria. Although the total number of U.S. special operation operators deployed in Syria may have approached as many as 5,000, the current headlines have not mentioned that the United States has special operation units deployed not just in Syria, but in a majority of the nations of the world. Wow. Over the past 17 years, the forces at the disposal of the U.S. Special Operations Command, SOCOM, have grown exponentially, more than doubled in size, with a budget that has also expanded fourfold in the same period of time. So here we are in the name of American democracy. Here we are, occupying other nations. If U.S. SOF troops do pull out of Syria, they may well still have a physical presence in over 70 nations on any given day. Although the public has an often vague and incomplete unofficial explanation of the reasons behind these deployments, the Pentagon seems totally unwilling to explain the national defense rationale or legitimacy of these missions to anyone, including U.S. Congress or the White House. So it's a big secret. It's so special, it's secret. It's so secret, it's special. Right? So you pull out of Syria, and you've got another 70 similar situations around the world, right? So when you say that, you're 1% telling the truth. Oh, we're pulling out of Syria. Yeah, it's a truth. But what about the other 99% lie that we're not out of the other parts of the world? Occupy. We're an occupation nation. Right? That's what this says to me, right? It's like that's what we are. We're fucking, you know, even I know people like to talk about Reagan and the times of Reagan, when Reagan inspired the world and he fought the Cold War. But the thing about the 80s rise of America, the 70s and 80s, was not a military rise. It wasn't military might that won, although we did come to the rescue of those in World War II in Europe, but the real rise was the American way. It was apple pie and Chevrolet, right? That's what sold it. American music, American art, American culture, the hippies, the freedom of expression, based on the United States Constitution, right? Civil rights, equal rights, right? These are the things that inspired the world. And that's how the United States expanded. But now we're expanding in a way that is, I mean, I see the United States as a cancer. You may not agree with that, but in a body, like my background was in biology in college. I studied biology and biopsychology, right? When if you study like cancer, for example, cancer is a small cell, and then it gets bigger and bigger. It doesn't take over the whole body. The whole body doesn't become cancer, but this one cancer causes all the other body parts to give up, right? To give up its source, its source of energy, right? And it slowly kills everything around it. Right? And you could say that, I mean, again, people don't want to believe this, but I mean, the sheer population, the sheer numbers of humans on Earth is in effect, is very, very similar. If you study the pathology of cancer, you could see how human beings on Earth are a cancer of sorts. It's overthrowing everything else. And in terms of foreign policy, the United States is very similar to that. It acts as a cancer in other nations, right? So, but nonetheless, we have all these soldiers deployed all over the world, right? Public, the new Spartans Act to protect U.S. interests. A lot of fucking U.S. interests. What, protect U.S. corporations? Since the inception of the global war on terror, shortly following September 11, 2001, special operations have more than doubled from approximately 33,000 to almost 70,000 today. Today, Special Operations Command has roughly twice the personnel at its disposal, but also four times the budget. So here's all the tax money going down the drain. Here's the big American teaching the Africans how to shoot guns or whatever the hell they're doing. These are the occupations just in Africa alone. Look at all the red, the darker orange, right? The darker orange is occupation, and I guess the other ones aren't, right? So this is in 2017. We're in every goddamn country. We're everywhere. Right? That's what we're doing. So here's one more article I want to say, how it connects to the global market, right? So with France, with the yellow vests taking France down, Germany is now on the ropes. England is ready to – Germany's on the ropes in terms of its production, its manufacturing numbers. Plummeting, right? And Brexit, right? We have Brexit now. It looks like the EU is going to do, it looks like the Europe, England is going to do a sloppy exit, in my view. That's what it seems like, that there is no deal. The EU is not going to let them out, right? They're trying to push Britain to get out before the EU elections for whatever reason, right? So it looks like a sloppy exit for England out of the EU. France is on the ropes, right? France is the French people are rising up against oligarchy, right? You have this staggering number right here, manufacturing in Germany plummeting over the last 2 years, right? Because again, Europe doesn't make anything, right? So it does have, my point is that it is one of the reasons, the economy, stupid, is one of the reasons why the United States continues this expansionism. And it's going into now, you know, Venezuela. Let's talk about Venezuela. I was gonna do these in two separate stories, but let's talk about it. So Venezuela, the big story is that everything is so socialist that Maduro is a dictator and he's starving his people, right? Now, go to, this is amazing work, Pulitzer Prize winning work by Max Blumenthal. I know everybody's going to say, oh, yeah, he's a Soros. Hey, you get a fucking echo. Soros is sponsoring him. He's a socialist, right? Fuck you, right? Do your research, right? Max Blumenthal, he's a guy. He went down to Venezuela and reported on the actual conditions of Venezuela. And now he's sitting in the UN at the UN giving a speech.
I arrived in Caracas in early February with the expectation of witnessing at least some mild version of the dystopia that Western media has made out Venezuela to be. What I found instead was a society coping with an economic crisis, to be sure, brought on by speculation, hyperinflation, and a tightening U.S. economic blockade. But
what? I thought it was Maduro's a dictator and he's killing his people, right? But Blumenthal was there for a month and he said no, it's overt speculation by a ruling class, a wealthy class. And then again, it's like everywhere else, right? That the 99% are being choked by a ruling class, a 1% hoarding all the money, speculation, right? It's unfettered capitalism. It's not socialism, right? That's the point of it, right? So he's making this he makes this brilliant one. He went down there, he saw the food line, he saw the food distribution centers in you know, mainstream Venezuela. He also saw the wealthy neighborhoods where everything is so abundant. It's just like you might as well have been in the village in Manhattan, right? It was the same. Every possible thing that you wanted, right? So
watch this coping movie. Nonetheless. I came from Washington, D.C., where I live in one of the city's most neglected, impoverished communities in Southeast Anacostia, whose residents are struggling to remain in their homes against rising rents and declining wages, and where I witnessed literally thousands of men and women sleeping in the streets every day just blocks from the White House. And, you know, coming from there, the situation around Caracas scarcely resembles a humanitarian crisis, at least as I understood it, especially after having worked so long inside and writing about the Gaza Strip.
So an experienced journalist has experience of the Gaza Strip. He knows poverty and humanitarian crisis when he sees it. And he's walking around in Venezuela saying, what? I don't see any humanitarian crisis. But then he goes home to Washington, D.C., and there's homeless people living at, you know, blocks from the White House in tents. Right, or in Seattle, come to New York, go wherever it's. So it's such a fucking lie. And where does it come from? It's the war machine, right? It's the war machine. It's oil, right? So go. You can go through this on your own. There's one other piece.
Which is still under.
All right, so he does this. He shows the jerkies at the UN.
We are in Parroquia Macarao in the outskirts of Caracas at a food market where food is being sold below market value, subsidized by the city of Caracas, overseen by the mayor of Caracas.
Remember when CNN said there's no toothpaste, there's no nothing, no toothbrush, no food?
And you can see behind me, it's toothpaste. You hear you have all the
right? You remember when they said that? All that shit, all this food. Look, so it's food, right? It is abundant. There's not a shortage of food. They're priced out, right? In this country, in America, we're priced out of property. We're priced out of, you know, so many other things, right? But in their country, they're having the oligarchs went for their food supply, right? They have plenty of gas. They can travel and move around. Gas is very cheap, right? They have free public transportation, or very, very, like 3 cents or 2 cents, very cheap.
Basic foodstuffs, pasta, flour. They're focusing on protein here, so you have...
So there you have it. He's showing you all the food. Look,
she's taking away a fat bag of...
bread, and then you go...
So one resident who received the clapback has let us borrow it just to show you what's in it. All the products here are made in Venezuela, and we also see we have some soybean oil, and this soybean oil apparently is made by the government of Venezuela.
I'm Anya Parampil reporting from Simón de Bolívar Square in Caracas, where thousands of Venezuelans have been waiting in line for hours to sign an open letter to the American public denouncing U.S. intervention and aggression against their country.
What? I thought it was the opposite. I thought they wanted Maduro out. They want the United States out. Oh, they're lining up by the millions. How come CNN didn't report about this? If I didn't hear it, did you? Where's fucking CNN? I'm waiting for it. It has, it ties into the military stuff, because you could see that expansionism through the use of special operations is something that the United States does. There is a connection there. Come on, man. Give me a break.
¿Verdad? Porque nosotros aquí le elegimos un presidente. No a Guaidó, que está por allá. No, aquí elegimos a un presidente.
Con voto.
¿Ves? Y lo proclamó el pueblo.
We affirmed Maduro with votes, right? Not the other guy, Guaidó. So let's talk about that for a second. So here's Guaidó, right? Now, Sitco, right? You heard this? This is another, I'll throw another story at you. Guaidó, Sitco snubs U.S. Executives in Caracas jail, right? You heard the story? So there's six guys sitting in jail that work for Sitco Oil, which is the state-run oil in Venezuela, right? And so these six people are sitting in jail, and let's find out why they're sitting in jail. When the Trump administration paved the way for Venezuelan opposition leader Juan Guaidó to name a new board to run the U.S. affiliate of Venezuela's state oil company, it was a rare glimmer of hope for the American families of six oil executives jailed for over a year without a trial in the politically turbulent South American nation. But a month later, the families explained they are still being left to fend for themselves as much as ever by the men's employers, Sitco. All right, so that's crazy, right? So there's a bunch of guys sitting in jail. What did they do? Sitco, where's the allegation? Get right to it. Sitco, the eighth largest refiner in the U.S. and Venezuela's biggest foreign asset, has emerged as a major prize in the battle for power in Venezuela between Juan Guaidó and President Nicolas Maduro, who heads the opposition, with U.S. and 50 nations backing their legitimate leader, Juan Guaidó. But the people don't support it. The people don't recognize it. Please. Families insist their loved ones are collateral damage. Yeah, they probably are. But let's see what the deal is. Their trial began the weekend before Thanksgiving 2016, when six executives got a call from the head of PDVSA summoning them to Caracas for a last-minute budget meeting. Once there, armed and masked security agents busted into the conference room and arrested them on embezzlement charges stemming from a never-executed proposal to refinance $4 billion in Sitco bonds by offering 50% stake in the company as collateral. Maduro himself accused them of treason. You gave away 50% of our assets. What are you, fucking crazy? Treason. We love it. Hold on a second. I got Batman. Batman nipping at me. He's biting my leg. So there you go. So in their own country, in their own nation, they have determined that these guys are traitors, right? How dare you? $5 billion, $4 billion in half of our assets? Fuck you, right? Treason, right? So these people are crying, oh, my fucking love, oh, my loved one, ah. Well, don't go to someone else's country and steal their oil, right? That's what I say to you. I mean, all due respect, right? And we have to snap and, you know, where's fucking Juan Guaidó? Where's Juan Guaidó talking about the people getting choked, right? So anyway, this is just another thing. They're not going to get out. I mean, so there you have it. Maduro is literally holding six people in jail in Caracas for treason. Don't fuck with our oil, right? They're serious, right? So it ties into this whole special operations, American might abroad. That's how we expand into other nations. There's no humanitarian crisis in most of these places, and we go in and create it through sanctions, through bully tactics. If you know, we threaten your neighbors. We go to your neighbor and say, "Oh, you deal with this guy, we'll you got to deal with us, right?" It's like the mob, right? So we're not demilitarizing. We're escalating the military occupation in our own name, you know? So I don't like it. You know what I mean? Like, I just don't like it, you know? What's old is good. Marcus, copy your point.